Just a couple of years ago, the Tea Party was the most powerful force in politics. Now some political experts are asking, is the Tea Party dead?
Well, Pat, some politicians say yes, and maybe some say the same thing in the media. But the Tea Party itself plans to have the final word. David Brody has the story.
The predictions began soon after election night 2012. CNN declared the end of the Tea Party movement, and the Washington Post exclaimed how the movement will soon be nothing more than a blip in the country's collective memory. Mitt Romney's loss, combined with a few Tea Party stumbles, led to a perception that the so-called movement was a bunch of ultra-conservatives who cost Republicans congressional seats. Within the GOP establishment, they're seen as a nuisance who just won't compromise.
That's the same 40, 50 chuckleheads that all year, starting with H.R. 1, the entire Congress have screwed this place up.
Now, GOP guru Karl Rove could be looking to put a nail in the coffin, too. His new political action committee, the Conservative Victory Project, will be backing electable candidates during GOP primaries in 2014. The Tea Party reads the word electable as code for squishy moderate Republicans, and that has them seen red.
So here is a project funded by crony capitalists, funded by corporatists who are not conservative.
The Tea Party says, much like Mark Twain, reports of its death have been greatly exaggerated. While polls show Tea Party identification dropping from 24% in 2010 to just 8% today, there have been key wins. Newly minted Senators Ted Cruz and Deb Fischer join a growing constitutional conservative group made up of Marco Rubio, Mike Lee, Tim Scott, and Rand Paul. In the House, more than 50 Tea Party members make up a strong voting bloc. Ultimately, Tea Party leaders say the key to a sustainable national movement is electing House and Senate candidates who are ready for prime time.
We require our candidates for endorsement to have a path to victory in their campaign.
Julie Turner is president of the Texas Patriots. Turner says the way to keep the movement on track is by grooming candidates on the local level and growing a bench of all-stars.
It became clear to us that what we needed to do was to build kind of a farm team, start at the easiest elections, bring people into our weekly meetings.
Here in San Antonio, the Alamo has come to represent the ultimate sacrifice in freedom. And that's exactly the way the Tea Party sees themselves, as freedom warriors. And so when everybody talks about whether or not the Tea Party is dead, well, here in Texas, it's anything but.
The Tea Party kept a serious presence in the state capitol, convincing lawmakers to rein in spending. In places like Beaumont and many other cities, Tea Party members meet each week to plot strategy.
A lot of people like to see us give up, but that's not going to happen.
For people that think the Tea Party is dead, what's your message to them?
No, the Tea Party's not dead. I think they're resting.
Much like their GOP counterparts, image is a problem. Since the media has turned the Tea Party into a four-letter word, conservative bloggers suggest a four-part strategy: rebrand, retool, recruit, and reengage.
This is generational. It started with the founding of this country. It will always happen. Our name will change. The faces will change. The principles will not.
David Brody, CBN News, in Beaumont, Texas.
Well, the Tea Party's been demonized because they were powerful. And the Tea Party's trying to get the government to cut back on its massive deficits. But the president and the Republicans have different ideas about how to do that. Lee Webb has more on that vital story from the CBN newsroom.
Pat, President Obama is trying to avoid automatic spending cuts that are set to go into effect on March 1st unless the deficit is cut. The cuts would hit the military and domestic programs. The president wants Congress to come up with a short-term measure to reduce the deficit. His plan includes some short-term spending cuts along with higher taxes. But Republicans are against any new taxes. The president's proposal comes as the Congressional Budget Office projects that spending on health care and retirement programs will keep driving the national debt higher, and that 7 million Americans will lose their health care coverage at work under Obamacare. Pat?
You know, like it or not, the Republicans are guilty And I think it's time we have a mea culpa from the Republicans as well as the Democrats. They've been voting for some of these outrageous spending. They've been voting for the various pork barrel projects, the mark items on the budget that they think are special to them. And when you look at George Bush, he did a lot of good stuff, but he was a big spending liberal. So we started these huge deficits under his administration. It's been accelerated under Obama, and something's got to be done on a bipartisan basis to say we can't afford it any longer. And it's time to say no. And so it isn't Democrat, Republican, it is American. It is how do we save this great land for our children and grandchildren? That's what we're looking at, and the CBO is supposed to be nonpartisan, and they're sounding an alarm. Let's listen to them. Lee.
Pat, British lawmakers voted overwhelmingly in favor of a bill to legalize same-sex marriage. Prime Minister David Cameron championed that legislation. But some of his strongest opposition came from his own party. Charlene Israel has that story.
The ayes to the right, 400. The noes to the left, 175. So the ayes have it. The ayes have it.
It's the first of several votes required for the UK's marriage bill. If it becomes law, the legislation would enable same-sex couples to marry in both civil and religious ceremonies, as long as the religious institution consents.
Today was about, do we accept the fundamental principle of gay people being allowed to call their union a marriage? I'm glad that we do.
Marriage is a great institution, and it should be there for people who are gay as well as people who aren't. That's why I've pioneered this change.
The vote went Cameron's way, but it cost him popularity within his own party. More than half of his 303 conservative lawmakers voted against or abstained from voting for the bill.
Many people, yes, it's a non-issue. But to a lot of people, they feel that this is maybe the straw that has broken the camel's back.
Who are we? Who is this government? Who is this country? To determine, impose, nationalize a new definition of marriage, which will have huge implications.
I think that when people begin to understand the full ramifications of it, I think people are going to be very concerned.
Some conservatives also fear the issue will cost the party a lot of votes in the next general election. If passed, the bill would come into effect in 2015, right ahead of that election. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Pat, what do you think of this?
Well, I think it's one more step down the slippery slope. The Bible is very clear about what is permissible and what isn't permissible. And the church has been the arbiter of marriage. This is a holy sacrament performed in a church. Now, civil unions are unions that are blessed by the state, by justice of the peace, or by some civil official. And that's one thing, but marriage is something that is ordained of God. And the Bible says, for this cause shall a man leave his mother and father and cleave to his wife, and the twain shall be one flesh. That's what it says. And then it also talks about what's going to happen to those who engage in other forms of sexual activity. It isn't that people are pointing fingers, nor is it trying to prohibit somebody from enjoying all the benefits of society. But this is a sacrament. It's like saying the government is going to say who's going to take communion in the Catholic Church, who's going to be allowed to go to seminary and be ordained as a priest, who is going to determine that. Are we going to have a vote in Parliament to determine who is qualified? Do we want that in America? And the answer, of course, is no. Well, we just keep extending these civil liberties. Why? Well, what's going on? Well, it's an assault on traditional Judeo-Christian morality that has been going on for some time. It has to do with procreation, has to do with sexual mores, has to do with the nurture of children and the ability of children to live. And this is the big battleground. And we apparently are falling down before the forces that are want to change this society. And we'll have to see what that does to us down the road. Lee?
Pat, a newly disclosed document exposes how much lethal force the administration can and will use against terrorists, even if they're American citizens. The document from the Justice Department says American citizens tied to Al-Qaeda can be killed if, quote, an informed high-level official believes the target poses an imminent threat. The document goes on to say the government is not required to have clear evidence. Even the White House press corps questioned the administration on the apparent double standard.
How does dropping a bomb on an American citizen without any judicial review, any trial, not raise the very human rights questions or more human rights questions than something like waterboarding?
The president understands the gravity of these issues. That is why he is committed to taking very seriously his responsibilities in this.
Carney went on to say that targeted strikes are legal, ethical, and wise, and he added they're necessary to prevent future attacks on the U.S. A magnitude 8 earthquake struck the South Pacific today north of Australia. The quake generated a tsunami that reached up to 5 feet. It damaged dozens of homes and left several people missing and presumed dead across the Solomon Islands. The island chain lies on the so-called Ring of Fire, an arc of earthquake and volcanic zones where about 90% of the world's earthquakes occur. Iran's President Ahmadinejad is in Cairo. It is the first visit to Egypt by an Iranian leader in more than 3 decades. The two countries have not had ties since the Islamic Revolution in Iran in 1979. Ahmadinejad talked with Egypt's Islamist President Mohamed Morsi. Some Sunni Muslims weren't happy about the visit. They're angry because Iran's leaders are Shiite Muslims, and they have supported Syrian dictator Bashar Assad. Ahmadinejad was forced to flee from an ancient mosque in Cairo after a Syrian protester took off his shoes and threw them at him. Despite the tensions, Morsi gave Ahmadinejad a red carpet welcome at the Cairo airport, Pat.
Well, sooner or later, there's going to be a struggle. We'll find that struggle taking place in the Middle East between the Sunnis and the Shias, and it can be very violent and very nasty. And I think, of course, when you look at Syria, the Assad family, or Alawite, which is a small sect, it isn't even one of the main branches, but they've held power in Syria for many, many years. So we'll see what happens. But That's coming, and it's going to get more intense.
The Pentagon is set to extend benefits to same-sex partners of military personnel. Defense Secretary Leon Panetta has not made a final decision on which benefits will be included, but here's what he's considering: allowing same-sex partners access to the on-base commissary and other military stores, and some health and welfare programs. Full benefits, like housing and medical benefits, would require the repeal of the Defense of Marriage Act. The federal law forbids the U.S. government from recognizing any marriage other than those between a man and a woman. President Obama is planning his first trip to Israel since taking office in 2008. The visit is planned for this spring at some time, but the White House has not released the dates or itinerary. His last visit to Israel, though, was during his first presidential campaign in 2008. The decision has drawn criticism from some pro-Israel groups who say the administration is not supportive of the U.S. closest ally in the Middle East. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.